So definition, a topological space X is first countable in a point
X and X. If there is a countable system of neighborhoods, so countable, U1, U2, U3, so it's countable, system of neighborhoods, such that this is neighborhoods, no? It's too long, so neighborhoods. U1, U2, U3, U4, and so on, such that given an arbitrary neighborhood, U of X, neighborhood U of X of this point, there exists some index here. There exists n in n such that un is contained in U. Un is contained in U. Some of these is contained in U. Okay? U is for any neighborhood. We can also assume that U1 contains U2 smaller, decreasing, okay? Smaller and smaller. U3 and so on. We can also assume that this holds, okay? Why? We can assume that we just take intersections now. So here it's clear we take decreasing set of neighbors, okay? So we take, if you have this one here, no? U1, U2, U3, okay? Then we always can do this, U1 and U1 intersection U2, U1 intersection U2, intersection U3, and so on. So this is decreasing then, okay? This is if it's not decreasing, then doing this we get a decreasing system of neighborhood. Okay. So there's a problem. What? Okay. So this is sometimes called a fundamental system of neighborhoods of X, okay? Fundamental, with this condition probably, because this is a strong condition. That means, of course, un is in U, but then also the others are all, okay? Because they are decreasing and so they are all in U, okay? So then, of course, is called in U for I bigger equal to n, then all the others which come out. Those are getting smaller and smaller, okay? So this is called a fundamental system of neighborhood. Fundamental system. Not in the book of neighborhoods of this point of X. fundamentals. So what we first countable means, we have a fundamental system of neighbors, countable. A countable fundamental system, and fundamental is this condition, this or this, okay, which are equivalent, okay? X is first countable if it's first countable in every pod, okay? X is first countable. If X is first countable in every point X, X and X. So first countable. There's a local condition, no? In some point, first countable. And first countable, then if it's for, it's a local condition. So the important condition probably is this here. Now this is a fundamental system of neighborhood, okay? Decreasing system. And then if you have any neighborhood, at a certain point, this is contained in this neighborhood, okay? And then also everything which comes after this, of course. The main example is, of course, this is modeled on example. If X is metric, a metric space, metrizable, a metric, okay? Then X is first countable, of course. X is first countable. Why? Well, if you want this condition, what do we take? We take take UN equal to UI equal to the ball, open ball, around X with radius 1 over I. Okay? This is decreasing anyway, okay? And if you have an arbitrary neighborhood in the metric topology of X, then there is some of these balls, no, contained for some epsilon, and then so this is the case, okay? A metrizable space, metric space, is first countable in each point. So it's first countable. So it seems almost... so this metrizable is not a topological condition, no? It's not topological, it's metric, okay? But this is a topological condition, no? First countable. So metric implies first countable, okay? So this is a, for being metrizable, first countable is a necessary condition, okay? Necessary. If it's not first countable, okay, it cannot be metrizable. That's a topological, that's a necessary, so maybe that's worse to write it. So, being first countable is a necessary, it's the same as this, but it's a way to say it. It's a necessary topological condition for being metrizable. And to recall, the metrization problem is to find necessary and sufficient conditions, okay? Which are at the same time necessary and sufficient, okay? So maybe normally you say, well, maybe first countable, that's it, okay? That's the same. And Hausdorff. First countable does not imply Hausdorff. Hausdorff you need anyway, okay? So if it's Hausdorff and first countable, no? Then try to prove it's metrizable, okay? But it's not true. Okay, unfortunately it's not. Well, we can think about an example later, okay? It's not true. It's not sufficient also. We need more conditions. We have to find other conditions, okay? So anyway, this is the important thing, okay? Metrizable space is first countable. In fact, first countable is modeled on metrizable, okay? With this as a fundamental system of neighbors, the balls of radius 1 over. And then, of course, remark, the sequence lemma holds if we replace metrizable by first countable. The same proof, okay, so I write that. So observation. The sequence lemma which we did yesterday, no? Holds if one replaces. So in the sequence lemma, there's a condition in one direction metrizable, metric, okay? Metric, metrizable. Maybe I forgot metric or metrizable, but it's the same, okay? It's just a different point of view. Metric by first countable. Then the sequence lemma holds. We don't need metric. We need first countable. Just in the proof, just replace. So also that I will write in the proof. Of the sequence lemma, just replace. So there was. This ball, okay, B, D. In the sequence lemma, use these balls for one direction, x, 1 over n, no? By un, okay? By un. So where this is, un is the fundamental system of neighbors, okay? Where u1 contains u2, contains, so we need this condition here, no? And so on, it's a fundamental system of neighbors. That means every neighborhood contains one of these, and then also all which come after this, okay? It's the same proof, exactly, okay? You just write un when you see bd 1 over n, okay? And then it's the same proof. So this means that these spaces are not metrizable, but so this means then that they are not first countable, no? So R omega with box topology, that's what we did last time, no? With box topology is not first countable. It's not first countable. Well, in just one point we did it, okay? In the point zero, okay? We use zero. It's not first countable in zero. In the point zero in R omega, okay? Because we use the sequence lemma, no? We use the sequence lemma. So R omega with box topology is not first countable in omega, so it's not metrizable, okay? That's what we did yesterday, but it's not first countable, it's the same proof. And Rj, j uncountable. That was the second, is not first countable with the product topology, with product topology now. Here's with box topology, and now with product topology, that's what we did yesterday, with product topology, is not first countable. Again, in the same point, we use this point in zero in Rj, no? So this may be. Parenthesis, there's one point where it's not first countable. Then it's not first countable, okay? Just one point. It's not metrizable. So it's a nice condition for being first countable. The sequence lemma holds, no? for spaces which are connected. So if you sequence lemma means if you have a point in the boundary, okay, now a limit point if you want, and it's Hausdorff also, okay, then we have infinitely many points, and then we find a sequence, okay. Now then we find a sequence which converges. That's a sequence lemma, okay, but it has to be first countable, or which is maybe stronger, metrizable, okay. It is metrizable is stronger. They're not equivalent. Okay, and other examples. Proposition or observation, proposition, easy. If x is second countable, then it's first countable. Second countable implies x first countable. So if it's second countable implies first countable. Second countable is a global condition, no? Second countable means there's a so proof. There is a countable basis. That's a global condition, no? First countable is a local in each point, we can say, no? So proof, what means first second countable? Let B be a countable basis. For x, and now we have to prove first countable. Okay, so and let x be in a point in this point as you and let x be a, choose a point x in x. Then what I take is I consider b prime. Here I take all b in b. I just take all basis elements which contain x, okay? All basis elements which contain x. The others are not interesting for this point. And B is countable, so this is countable, okay? So B prime is countable, of course. So B prime is countable. So B prime is, we can count it, no? B1, B2, B3, no? It's countable. So B1, B2, B3, and so on. It is certainly countable. And now we find, so this is already the definition. If you have a, we have to prove. And we can order these, no? No, we can make it decreasing, no? Let's say, so you can U1 equal B1, okay, the first of these. U2 equal what you take, B1 intersection B2, no? U3, B1 intersection B2 intersection B3, and so on, okay? So we get a decreasing system, U1, U2, U3, U4, 4. And if, of course, I have to prove that this is fundamental. So, but that's the definition of topology generated by the basis, no? If U is any neighborhood of X, then there exists, of course, a basis element. Then there is. That's the definition of the topology generated by a basis, no? Then there is B in B, such that x, which contains x in B, okay? So this means B is in B prime, in the other one, okay? So B is really in B prime, because it contains x. It's the neighborhood of x, okay? So it's one of these. That's it, okay? So given any neighborhood, we find one of these which is contained in this neighborhood, okay? And then taking intersections, we can make it decrease. We get arbitrary small neighborhoods. So this is second countable implies first countable. Second countable implies first countable. We need some other condition for metrizable already. But there's one missing condition, which comes later, which is one of these conditions, T3, T4, okay? T1, T2, T3, T4, no? Which is normal or regular, one of these two. And then it turns out, together with this condition, first countable is, as we already know, in any case, necessary, okay? Second countable, together with this condition, is sufficient for being metrizable. So we are between first and second countable. So this is an interesting notion, okay? Metrizability is, together with some other condition, normal, which we do later, but it's between first and second countable, somewhere between. It's not clear where, okay? It might be first countable, it's not. It might be second countable, it's not, okay? One is necessary, the other is sufficient. So these are interesting conditions anyway. What else? So this is first countable, okay? Now we know what is first countable. So metric spaces are first countable, second countable spaces are first countable, okay? Let me think one second. I didn't think about it. So we want a first countable space. We need another condition, of course. No, we want a first. If we want a first countable space, which is not metrizable, okay? So it's not necessary. It's not sufficient, okay? A first countable space which is not metrizable. A metrizable space is first countable, okay? But we want to see that's the other inclusion. We want a space which is. Then we need another condition, no? Hausdorff, of course. Hausdorff we want always, okay? But we want a first countable space which is not metrizable. Then we need another condition, okay? Which distinguishes, okay? Because other, how to prove, no? And so we have to find this, another condition. Well, we will see that later. That's not the point now, okay? So this is first countable, important condition for. Then in the first chapter, which I close now, I just give one more definition, which more or less is easy, and but it's used often, and there will be some exercises, okay? I will get exercises, so the next week I'm not in here, okay, in three somewhere. So I don't know, you have other lectures, I suppose. Do you know? Other courses, no? We see, also not next week, but the week after next week, okay? I will give today some other exercises. So definition, last definition in this is quotient map, okay? So X and Y are topological spaces that we talked a little bit about already, X and Y. F from X to Y, a function, a map. F from X to Y is a quotient map. So what is a quotient map? If a quotient map, that's just a name, it's continuous, of course. We are in topology, so certainly it should be continuous. Quotient, taking quotients means surjective also, okay. Surjective. And the following condition holds. That's the important condition. Now, this is okay, but and the following holds. So V is a subset V of Y is open in Y, okay, V is open in Y if and only if its pre-image is open in X. F minus 1 of V, its pre-image is open in X. That's the condition, okay? One direction here is anyway, I don't have to write this, okay? Because it's continuous, no? Anyway. Continuous means if V is open in Y, then of course f minus 1 of v has to be open x. That's continuity, okay? Interesting is the other direction here, okay? If and only if. So as a remark, given the topology on x, then y, given the topology on x, then y has the finest topology such that f is continuous. That's again such a situation, okay? Then y has the finest topology such that f is continuous. No, we take as many open sets as we can, okay? But the preimage have to be open, okay? We need this condition that the preimage is open. So, and then this is the definition then of, that's the quotient topology also the name, okay? So this is the quotient topology. Quotient map, quotient topology. This is the quotient topology. On X. On Y, sorry. Because this is the maximum we can take. We say if something is open in Y, okay, then of course the preimage has to be open in X, no? So we take exactly those, okay? We cannot take more, because then F would not be continuous, no? We take exactly those, and this is a topology, and this is a quotient topology. And the map is called a quotient map. So the quotient topology, quotient map, okay. Just names. But that we saw examples, okay? The finest, the largest topology such that something is continuous, no? That's a typical situation. The coarsest topology is not interesting, no? Because that's indiscrete, no? If we give here the indiscrete topology, then everything is continuous, no? So here we have to take the finest. That's an interesting topology, okay? And this is a quotient topology. And then this is called a quotient map, okay? That's just a definition. There will be one exercise today, I'll just give the definition here. There are some exercises. Okay, so this, in some sense, finishes the second chapter. That's what I do of the second chapter. And now, because I have to give exercises, I'll start with the third chapter. The third chapter of the book is on connected spaces, okay? So I give some condition, some definitions now for connected spaces, okay? And then the next one is compact. But there are various notions of connected and compact, okay? Not just one. So we see two for connected, at least two, okay? There are more. We will see. Connected, arc connected, locally arc connected, locally connected, no? And compact also, compact, limit point compact, sequentially compact. So there are various notions, and we will discuss this a little bit, okay? This is. So now I start with connected, because I will give two, three exercises, okay, for connected spaces. You have 2 weeks, so. I don't give too many. So this is a quotient topology, and now I give some definitions and some basic facts about connected. So we have connected, what is called connected spaces. Connected spaces. Connectivity. So I give the basic definitions. So we have a definition. So connected is very connected means you cannot separate the space in two open subsets, which are non-trivial. Okay, There's one open subset and another, and the space is just a union of two open subsets. Okay, that's not connected. Okay, that would be a separation of the space. So what is a separation? A separation. It's just a way to talk. A separation of a topological space X is a pair UV. Is a pair, well, UV of subsets of X. And then I list the conditions. It's just an abbreviation of the conditions, so we don't have to say all of these conditions, which is non, okay. A separation of a topological space is a pair UV of subsets of X such that. So what are the conditions? That's the point. It's a way of talking. So the first condition is U and V are open. Well, U, V are open. The second condition is the X is a union of both. So it's a union of two open sets. Well, that's not a big thing. So they should be disjoint also, okay? Otherwise, it's trivial, no? So the next one is that U intersection V should be disjoint. So now we have a separation, okay? And there's missing one condition. It's not trivial, the separation, no? Because we have always the trivial open sets, which are the empty and the X. So this we don't want also. So U, V are different from empty set and X. I have to write just one, okay? Because these are complementary sets now. So they are both different from the one or both. So this is the separation. These are the conditions, separation, okay? That's exactly what I said. Separation means you separate in a non-trivial way into two open disjoint subsets, okay? X is connected if it has no separation. That's it, okay? X is connected. That's the definition of connected now. If there is no separation for X. Okay. That's the definition of connected. So first remark, which is the same, one might define also. So remark, observation, trivial. X is connected if and only if. So the complement, so these are complementary sets, no? U and V are complementary sets, right? U is a complement of V. They're all both open, but that means they are, as well write here closed, because V is a complement of U, and U is, okay? And U is open, so the complement is closed also. Also open, okay? So these sets are both open and closed, this U and V. So here can, so note that U, V are both open and closed here. Both open and closed. Okay. That's clear. Complementary set. So connected then means the only sets which are open and closed are trivial. That is empty or the whole. Okay. So the only sets. The only subsets of X, which are open and closed at the same time, no? Which are open and closed, are the empty set and X. These are always open and closed. But connected means there are no others. This is equivalent to the definition, okay, clearly. Because that's why I write. You note that, so here you note that UV are both open and closed in this definition. And non-trivial, okay? If it's not connected. If you have a separation. Connected, no separation. Example. RL. RL. It's not connected. Proving that something is not connected is easy in general, okay? Why? We just have to find one separation, okay? Proving that something is connected might be difficult because we have to prove there's no separation, no? That's another quality, no? Just one separation is easy to find in general, okay? So this is easy. Of course, being connected is useful. Being not connected is not useful, okay? So, clearly. So this is a separation. What is a separation? Somebody has a... What, so we have to find one separation, okay? So what is a separation? RL is equal... What? Sorry? Say again, from minus infinity... A open. So A is some point here, no? Choose any point here, yes. And now? Yes. Yes. It's a separation. That's what you say, no? That's a separation. It's a separation. Why is it separation? This is... I mean, the open sets are given any point here, you find the bases are half open intervals, right? But given any point here, you of course, you find a half open interval which contains the point, okay, and is contained here. And here the same, also for A. Here you cannot close, no? The only point, if you do, no, don't write it. If you write this, of course, it doesn't work, okay? Because this point, you don't find this neighborhood, okay? So you have to do it clearly. It's clearly you have to do it in this way. Because it's a lower limit topology, not the upper limit, no? So this is separation. They are open, they are disjoint, they are non-empty, what else? So we have everything here what we need. That's the separation, so it's not connected. That's easy, no? R, the standard R, that's not so trivial. No, that's analysis, okay? That is connected. But there we have to prove something. That we will prove a little bit more general, okay? RL is not connected. The reals with the standard topology, we will see, is connected, no? And this is an important fact from analysis also, okay? That's on the at the basis, yeah. That we will do. But that's more difficult, as I said, no? It's more difficult to prove something is connected. Proving it's not connected. But it's not so useful, no? It's just an example. Okay. No, some easy properties. Very easy properties. and then I just prove one small theorem. So, well, it's always called lemma in the book. So let lemma, okay, lemma. If x equals c union d, before it was uv, is a separation. So I don't have to write all these conditions, no? Is a separation. if X C union D is a separation of C, of X, sorry, of X, of course. And Y subset of X is connected. So what does it mean? Y is a subset, but it's a subspace, okay? And if you write this, Y subset of X is connected, means the subspace Y is connected, okay? Of X is connected. That's what it means, the subspace. So here is the subspace topology, no? The subspace, that's what it means. Y of X is connected. Then what you suppose, what seems reasonable is then Y is contained in C or in D, no? Or Y is contained in D. Because that's because otherwise, so the proof is very easy. Proof. So we have Y is equal to what? Y intersection C union Y intersection D, of course. They are both open because it's a subspace topology. They are of course disjoint. The union is everything. So so yeah, let's write this. Yeah, this is open, disjoint. Both are open and disjoint, no? But it's connected. So what? Yeah, something must be trivial. Yeah, okay. So this implies. So Y is connected. Y is connected. And all this together implies that something has to be trivial. Yeah, okay. So Y intersection C is empty. And this, of course, or Y intersection D is empty. And this, of course, implies that Y intersection C is empty is Y contained in D in the other one, Y contained in D or Y contained in C. That's so okay. So this is very easy. next property, lemma, another lemma. Which is small, easy lemma. So so we have a collection of subsets, okay? So suppose they are called A alpha in X are connected. This means A alpha are connected, okay? Subsets. Subspaces, subspaces, no? Are connected. Alpha in some index set, alpha j, no? Suppose the, all these are connected, subspaces, and they have at least one point in common. And the intersection of all these A alpha, alpha and j, is not empty. They have one point at least in common, okay? Then the union alpha and j is connected. Okay. So in other words, a union of connected subsets is connected if they have at least one point in common. Okay, that's another way to say that. A union. It's the same, but maybe a union of connected subsets is connected if they have at least one point in common, these connected subsets, okay? The intersection is not empty. That's the same. No? If they have at least one point in common. Okay, so this is the same, obviously. Proof. So what? So they have a point in common. So let's choose such a point. There's one point in the intersection, U alpha, alpha and J. So here's a common point. Suppose now that what we have to prove, the union, that's why, the union of A alpha, alpha and J. We take this union. We have to prove that it's connected, no? Suppose that this is a union now I might go by contradiction, okay, and say that this is a separation. But it's sort of not a good, maybe not a real contradiction. So what I assume, not the whole, I assume these are open, disjoint, and disjoint. Just these two. And then I prove one is empty, okay? No separation. No separation, okay? So open and disjoint. Suppose that Y can be written this way, open and disjoint. Suppose P is in P is somewhere, no? P is in C or in D, no? In the this is a union, okay? So suppose that P is in C. Okay? It must be in C or in D. So let's suppose it's in C. But A alpha is connected. A alpha is connected. Each A alpha is connected. This means that A alpha is contained in C or in D by the lemma, okay? The first lemma. This means a connected sub. Well, separation. A alpha is. I didn't write separation, no? But that doesn't matter. So it's contained here or here, okay? It's contained. Is contained in C or in D, which might be empty still, okay? But I don't care about that in this point, in C. However, P is in C, no? And this implies, of course, so P is in C. Suppose that P is in C. And this means that A alpha is in C, no? P is also in A alpha, and this implies A alpha is contained in C. But this is for all alpha, no? For each alpha. Right? And this means that the union A alpha alpha in J is equal to C, is C, we get C, okay? We don't get anything in D. And this means, so D is empty. So this means there's no separation. C has no, what? Y has no separation, no? This implies Y has no separation. This is almost a separation, except I prove it's this is empty or this is empty, no? Y has no separation. So this is the proof. You may, maybe you find it easier to write by contradiction. You write separation, and then, but this is, then at the end you prove one is empty, and then it's a contradiction, because that's not a separation, okay? But it's sort of a fake contradiction, okay? Because this kind of contradiction, where you start, we prove by contradiction, no? Okay, so let's assume it's not true. Then you prove it's true. And then you write, now we have a contradiction, because we assumed it's not true, no? But this is stupid, no? That's sort of not the very elegant style. Well, okay. So this is his lemma. Now, we have one last one. Next, what is next? Yeah, this is interesting, proposition. Let A in X be connected. Let A in X, let A be connected. Suppose this is connected. Be connected. And there's B between the and B. So A is contained in B, and this is contained in the closure of A. Closure of A in X, of course. So we have something, this is connected, and this is contained between A and the closure of A, okay? Then B is connected. Then B is connected. In particular, the closure of a connected subset is connected, okay? In particular, that's a special case. We can B take this one, okay? In particular, take B equal to, in particular, the closure of a connected subset we say subset, but it's subspace, okay? But subspace is too heavy, so subset. Of a connected subset is connected. That's a case, that is a case B equal to A closure, of course. Okay. So a proof. Also, this is easy. By contradiction now, maybe fake contradiction, the same kind of, but it's easier to write. Suppose it's a we have a separation. Suppose B, so we have, what I have to prove? B is connected, no? Suppose we have a separation. Suppose B equals C union D is a separation. Of B, of course, no? So this is a separation. A is connected. Subspace of X, subspace of B, subspace A, okay? This almost trivial remark, a subspace of a subspace is also a subspace of the large space, okay? A subspace of a subspace of a subspace of a subspace is a subspace of the also the large, no? And everything in between also, okay? So, okay. Suppose it's a separation of B. So with the lemma, some lemma implies A is connected, no? A is connected. So then, by the lemma, A is contained in C or A is contained in D, right? If we have a separation and something is connected, then it's in one or in the other, okay? Because it's connected. Suppose A is in C. doesn't matter. Suppose A is contingency. Okay. Suppose A is in C, yes. Then we want a contradiction, okay? A is in C. A is in C. Now, what is B, no? Then the closure of A is in the closure of C, of course. That's trivial, no? Then A. Then the closure of A is contained in the closure of C. And recall, this means closure in X, no? If we write this, we mean... Because there are many spaces around here, no? A is in B, B is in A bar is in X, no? There, but the closure means in the large space, no? In the, so closures, always, if you write it this way, it means closures in X. In X. Who's asking? Closure, if this sign here, no? If you write this sign, we mean always closure in the large, in X, in this original space, okay? For this inclusion? No, no, no. If A is in C, then A is in the closure of C. Then the closure of A is in the closure of C. Right? If A is in C, for example, then A is in the closure of C, because the C is contained in the closure of C. Then the closure of A is contained, because the closure is the what? Yeah, the smallest closed. And, okay? No problem. Okay. A, so then A is C, and this implies, of course, that, where are we now? A is in C. So B is in C, in the closure of C. This B is in the closure of C. Because this is contained here and then here, no? B is in the closure of C. So B is equal to, well, I write in a different way. B is contained in C, and of course it's contained also in B. So that's trivial, no? I just added B here, okay? It's contained in the closure of C, it's contained in B. But what is this? That's interesting. Yeah, that's the closure of C, but in B now, okay? This is closure of C in B. This is some lemma which we proved, okay? A lemma, which has no name. The closure in a subspace, how do you get that? Take a closure in the large space and intersect. Okay? That's an important fact. Okay? The closure in a subspace, you take the closure in the large space, which you write with this symbol, okay, and then you intersect. Take the closure in the large space, intersect. So this is the closure of C in B by a lemma. By a lemma. However, what is C? C is this, no? It's closed in B. But because this is separation. These are both open and closed, okay? Here. That's the separation of B, no? We are in B here. But C is closed in B. So this is C, since, okay? This is a closure of C. This is a closure, but C is closed, so it's equal to C, since C is closed, okay? It's clear, right? Yeah, C is closed in B. So what we have, this says that B is contained in C. And this, where is B? B is contained here. This means this is empty. And D is empty. And now, so it was not a separation, okay? So this was not a separation. So we have a contradiction, if you want, okay? Contradiction. Because we write separation here. So it's a contradiction. So that's it. Some other last easy property. So let me write here. So lemma, this is also lemma. This in some sense has the image of connected set is connected. So if F is continuous, F from X to Y is continuous. And X is connected. Then F of X is connected. So in a shorter way, continuous image of, yeah, exactly. A continuous image of a connected set is connected. Well, this might be also subset, no? Then you restrict. It still continues. So is of a connected set is connected. That's what it says, no? In short. So proof, very easy. Well, the only interesting point is we can assume that F is that we can assume that F is surjective. Assume that F from of X is Y. So that is so, which means that F is surjective. Why can we assume that? By taking co-restriction to the image, okay, that remains continuous. By taking the co-restriction, you recall we write that was co-domain domain or restriction co-restriction, and by taking the co-restriction to the image, which is still continuous, okay? So we can assume. And now it's trivial. Suppose y equal C union D is a separation. So y is not connected, okay? Suppose y is not connected. So we have a separation. And then, yes, we take pre-images, of course. Then X is equal to F minus 1 of C union F minus 1 of T. It's a separation. Also a separation. It's also a separation. So this means that's a proof, okay? But what did we prove? We proved that if y is not connected, then x is not connected, okay? So if y x is connected, then y is connected, okay? If y is not connected, then x is not. If y is not connected, we have a separation, okay? Then we have a separation of x, so x is not connected. So if x is connected, y is connected. Now this is AB equivalent to not A implies not B, okay? That's not by contradiction. Yeah, right. Why we need surjective here? Where do we need surjective here? Well, these are open then, okay, in Y now. Otherwise, if it's not surjective, they are open in the image, but not in Y maybe, okay? That's all. But it's okay, so the last thing for today, which I want to prove, and this is a nice exercise. It's a theorem. It's a nice exercise for product, and this is important, no? Product uniform box topology, okay? And it's a good exercise for these topologies. So I will give the proof. So the theorem is the following. A product of connected spaces is connected. Very easy, okay? So I already use a product. Whatever they are called, x alpha, alpha and j, a product of connected spaces is connected. If you say it this way, we mean with a product topology, okay? I said everything goes wrong with a box topology. This goes wrong with a box for the product topology, okay? So I write for the product. If you don't say anything, it's a product topology. Okay, that's a theory. Very short and easy. A product of connected spaces is connected. In the book, you find only finite products, the proof, in this new version of the book. No? In the old version of the book, you find this strangely, okay? But the interesting part of the proof is really the infinite case, so I give the proof now. No? It's not in the book, in the new version, okay? It does it for finitely many. This can be proved in, anyway. So there are two cases, proof. If you want to read the proof, I don't know if the old version of the book is in the library, okay? Probably yes, there's some old copy of the book. This is from 1985, no? You have the new one, okay? From 2000 something. And there I looked, and I think he didn't prove, only for finitely many, finite products, okay? But it's a very nice exercise for product. And for a finite product, this gets much less interesting because here you have product topology and box topology. For finite products, they're the same, okay? So not, you don't see even which one you have, okay? It's the same, so that's not so interesting. The difference comes for infinite products, okay, between product and box topology. So that's why the infinite case, in some sense, is much more interesting, okay, than the case of finite product. For a finite product, yeah. So proof. Anyway, we prove first the finite case, okay, in the first step, finite or finitely many. Well, we prove for two. Then finitely many, we can prove for two also, okay. By induction, we have for three, for four, for five. So first case, case of a product. Well, they're called x, y. X times y of two connected spaces. X and y. Okay. So we have a product of two, finite product of two. Well, this is by picture, okay? I make a picture. This is easy. You make a picture. So what we do? This is x cross y. So this is x and this is y. And now I choose a point which in y, I fix a point, okay, which is so let B, well, B doesn't matter, fix B in y. So here we have a point B, okay. This is B. This is B times, what is this? This is B times x, no? X times B is better, yes. I lost orientation coming from the right. So this is x times B, okay? Anyway, x times B is, this is a sign for isomorphism, for homeomorphism, okay? This is homeomorphic to x, homeomorphism. What is the homeomorphism? Forget B, okay? The canonical map, okay? Forget B in this direction and add B in this direction. That's a homeomorphism between this space and this space. So this point is not important, okay? So this is connected, okay? This is connected, so this is connected. Because this is connected, okay? So this is what you see here is connected, no? Not, I take any point in x, x in x, okay? And I take this one. Sorry, x. Okay? I take, what is this? This is now x times y, okay? What you see here is x times y. Clear, no? And again, x times y is homeomorphic to y in the same way as this, no? And so this is connected. Also, this is connected. Because y is connected, no? What you see, this is connected, this is connected. This is just x, this is just y, more or less, okay? Up to this point, which you can forget. So this means what you see here, this and this is connected, okay? So, x cross b union, union x small x cross y. This is called Tx. So now x is, this b is fixed now. This x may vary, okay, for any x. So this is, that's what you see here, no? This and union this, no? That's Tx, okay? What is this? Connected. Why is it connected? Yeah, they have a point in common, okay? By a lemma. Non-empty intersection. But that you can, B is fixed, but you can do it for any x here, okay? So here's another x. Here's a, okay. So you have Tx for each x, no? It's clear that x cross y is a union of Tx. X in x. That's, you see, no? You have all these lines. This you keep for all the same. But you get everything, okay? But the intersection of this Tx, what is that?
This line.
This line. So this is b times x times b. Where is it? Here, x times b. This is x times b, no? No, it's non-empty. That's all what we need. Yeah, right. Non-empty. So this means this is connected. A union of connected sets is connected if they have a point in common, okay? So this implies x cross y is connected. Okay. I mean, do you see the picture, no? Do you see everything in this picture? This is connected. This is connected. So the union of these two is connected. And now you vary this, okay? Tx. And then you get everything. But the intersection is non-empty. So this, you see everything in this picture, the proof, okay? You look at this picture and see the proof. So this implies then, of course, for finitely many, okay, by induction. If x1, xn are connected, then the product x1 cross xn is connected. Right, by induction. Which doesn't work for the infinite case, no? So now comes the interesting case in some sense. This is the final product, no? And this is easy by this picture. Now comes the infinite case, arbitrary case. And that's the interesting. Because here you don't see, this is also, okay, proof, but product box, all the same topology, no? You don't see the difference. But now you have to be careful because it doesn't, I will show by example, then it's not true for the box topology, okay, in the infinite case. It is not true. So this is, the general rule is for the box topology, nothing is true, almost, okay? Many things are true for the product, but almost nothing for the box. There are too many open sets. There are too many open sets. So you suspect connected, you have problems, no, with connected. No, if you have too many open sets, no, you find separations. Okay, easily. That we will see. There are so many open sets, no? It's not a discrete topology, okay? There are still more, but this is not connected. No, that's trivial. But also in the box topology, there's too many open sets but in the infinite case, no? And then you find easily a separation. That we will do after the proof of the second interesting case. So that's the second case. Now we have an arbitrary product. That's the second part. Well, I have to. 10 minutes. No, this clock is always. Yeah, 10 minutes, right. So now we have an arbitrary product. Product, so x is arbitrary product, x alpha, alpha and j. And these are connected. And we have to prove x is connected, OK? And now I try to imitate the proof for the finite case, OK? We try to do the same. So let, we fix a point. We do more, try to do the same. Let B be a point in X. Well, I fix a point in X now, in Y, it doesn't matter. So B alpha, alpha and J. Why is it called B? Well, I don't know, in X. So fix B, a point in X, OK? So for any finite subset of indices, okay, we have finite products here. Now we consider finitely many only, then we have no problem with connected. Okay? We know the finite case, right? If this would be a finite product, then it's connected. That's what we wrote. Okay? So that means for any finite subset, alpha 1, alpha n, of the index set, no? Let x alpha 1, x alpha 1, alpha n. So n is also arbitrary, no? N in n. Arbitrary finite subset. Let x alpha 1 be all, so we define this finite product. So we take all x alpha, alpha in j, in x. X is our, is a product, right? X is a product. Not as before, x times y. I want to define this, okay? This is a symbol which I define. So what I take? I take all points in X, okay, such that, such as what? X alpha, the coordinate, okay, is equal to B alpha. I fix this point, okay, is equal to B alpha for if it's constant. If alpha is not one of these indices, okay? If alpha is different from alpha 1, alpha n. Again, I take all points, okay, in x with coordinates x alpha, okay? For these indices, alpha 1, alpha n, I can take what I want, okay? For the other indices, it's constant. That's why I fix this point, okay? So I just take this constant point, okay? All the same. That's the definition of this set, okay? And now you say, you guess, what is this homeomorphic to? X alpha 1 times, you forget the constants again, okay? So this, what remains then is X alpha 1 times X alpha n, no? And the rest is constant, okay? It's homeomorphic, homeomorphism. By the way, you say, you don't use here that you have box or product. Doesn't matter, okay? For the box, for the product, this is a homeomorphism in any case, okay? Doesn't depend. But this, what is it? It's connected. That we know by the first case. So each x alpha 1 alpha n is connected, okay? So this, that's what we want to have. X alpha 1 alpha n is connected. Because it's homeomorphic to this. We still didn't use that we have the product topology. This is also okay for the box topology. So homeomorphism, we have to find the point, however, no? Because otherwise it's not true for the box. So if you don't use it, then something is wrong with the proof, no? Clearly. So this is connected. And now I take the union again, okay, over all these. So this is called Y. So let Y, so I take the union over all possibilities. X alpha 1 alpha n, take union over all these, okay, alpha 1 alpha n, where alpha 1 alpha n is a finite subset of alpha 1 alpha n. A finite subset. It's contained in J. Well, alpha 1, alpha n. It's contained in J, okay? And n is arbitrary in n, okay? N in n. So you take all finite subsets of J, okay? And you take the union. Of course, the intersection of all these is non-empty, no? There's B. So B is the point which is in the intersection of all these x alpha 1 alpha n. So this means this intersection is not empty, okay? I didn't write this. I write this the same here as here, okay? It's the same. So this is non-empty. But if you say these are connected, union of connected spaces, which at this one point is B is common point. So this means Y is connected, okay? So conclusion, Y is connected. No, say, if we are lucky, this is all x now, okay? Then we are done. But it's not true, of course. Because if you think about the union of these, then for finite subsets, okay, you have, if you take a point in this union, no? For a finite subset, you have arbitrary coordinates, no? But for the rest, you have always this b, okay? This is not the general point, okay, in general. Because there may be other points than the B, no? So it's not everything. And the claim, however, is so what you suppose? The closure of Y, however, is X. Okay? And that means X is connected. So this implies X is connected. The closure, yes. Okay. So we have to prove that the closure is X, right? That's all we have to prove, the last point. And we still have 2 minutes. So proof. Of this claim, no? That's a closure. So that means each point in X is in the closure, no? The closure is everything, okay? So we take an arbitrary point. So let X alpha, alpha and J, B in X. X is a product, or a product, infinite product, okay? What we have to prove? We have to prove that this is in the bound. This is in the closure, okay? This point is in the closure. So we take a neighborhood. So let X and, well, we take a basis neighborhood, okay? Immediately. And product U alpha and U equal product U alpha, alpha and J, be a neighborhood of X. sorry, this is point X now. And be a neighborhood of X. What we have to prove is that this has non-empty intersection with Y. No, that's what we have to prove, right? Non-empty intersection with Y. We still didn't use that we have the product topology, but we have to use it. Otherwise, the proof is wrong because it's not true for the product. Now we have to use it, okay? So we are neighborhood of X in the product topology, of course. We are in the product topology. This is the point. That's a nice proof in some sense. I mean, so this is a product. What does it mean, product topology? That means only finitely many, so these are U alpha, sorry, is open, of course, in X alpha in any case. Now that we know, okay? Product of open. But that's for the product topology means U alpha is equal to the whole space, no? By the way, so be a neighbor of X in the product. So then U alpha is equal to X alpha, except for finitely many indices, no? Except for finitely many indices. Right? That's the definition of the product. What are the finitely many indices? How would you suggest to call them? Alpha 1, alpha n. Alpha 1, alpha n. These are the finitely many indices in J, no? Well, you give some name, okay? Which we used before. And now we have to prove that the intersection is non-empty, okay? That's what we have to prove. So it's finished, the proof almost. Except we have to write that what we want to prove is that so we want to prove that this, yes, U alpha, no, alpha and J, intersection A, no, how's it called? Y is non-empty. That's what we want to prove, okay? Non-empty. That's what we want to prove, right? Then it's in the closure. So we have to find a point, okay? And this point, so we have to just to find one point, and this is easy to find. So then this Y alpha, alpha and J, so I just define a point. Is here. If we find a point, then it's not empty. Okay, so we have to define what is y alpha. Y alpha is equal to, and we have to be in y and in the product. Okay. And so what means in y? That means for finite, except for finitely many indices, we have to take b or point or fixed point. No. Except for finitely many indices. So we have to take B alpha if alpha is different from alpha 1, alpha n. Then it's constant, right? Even take our point B alpha. That's good for y, no? But that's good for this, because for these coordinates, we have the, if alpha is different from this, we have the whole space here. So we can take B alpha. So we are here. If alpha is equal to this, if alpha is an element of this, then what we take? Yeah, the only point we know then is X alpha, okay? X alpha. That's the only point which we are sure is here, no? So U alpha is open in X alpha, and of course, X alpha is in X alpha. It's a neighborhood, no? Because X is in U. It's a neighborhood, okay? So if we define it this way, then it's here because of the first, no? But it's also here. So, we found a point, so it's non-empty. And so this implies that the closure of Y is really X. Okay, we get everything. And this means X is connected, because Y is connected. So this implies X connected. Okay. That's a nice proof, okay? Here we... Next time I tell you an example that it's not true for the box topology. Or you want to see to understand it now? Or next time? What? We are almost done now. It's not true for the box topology or this theorem, okay? In the finite case, yes, but not in the infinite case. And then we have to just to find a separation, no? And that in general you see. So I do it next time, okay?